I've been waiting for this one for quite a while, ever since I was introduced to the band Daisy the Great. Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you so much for having us.
And I do want to take just a moment out to recognize the fact that you don't even have a show in Kansas City, and you have literally driven 9 hours out of your way to come be in the studio and play for our listeners. And I cannot thank you enough for, man, you guys are awesome.
Thank you. It's an honor to be here.
We're stoked.
So Daisy the Great, you may know them originally, and maybe not, but if you spend a lot of time on TikTok, I'd be surprised if you don't know the song Record Player. That might be your initial introduction, especially when they teamed up with AJR, though it went viral before that with some point of view horror thing. Do you want to talk about that at all?
Like, yeah, it had a couple of viral moments on TikTok before we even had, like, Minna and I didn't have TikTok, so we didn't really know what was going on, and a fan put it on TikTok. And in the beginning, it was a lot of, like, POV videos about like pretending to be your like dead twin, and then like some gore makeup stuff, and then that was the first bump. And
I
then,
loved that edition.
I know, we loved that it. And then the second one was like a one breath challenge of people trying to sing the chorus in one breath, which we don't do, but it's funny because we don't do that. But when we did the shows with AJR, the new version has like all of them are double choruses. So Minna and I were like, whoa, we actually do need to sing two now. Yeah.
Like, we had so to we be had like, to climbing sing, like, in the I've
six
got a record.
Choruses. And we're like, wow, this one's hard. Whoa. Good thing we like practiced all those one breaths. But yeah, it was very, very exciting.
Well, and I do want to mention that kind of right off the top, because it's a pretty reductive of your career in that you have got a lot of music that you've written. It's a beautiful song. It's a great song.
Thank you.
I would love, I know that we're going to hear it here in a minute, and I'm looking forward to it because it's wonderful. There's a reason that it got all of the attention that it did. But you now have a new album out called All You Need Is Time on S-Curve. And I'm getting a lot of Beatles references from you all. And I know I've read, I mean, Beatles, little bit of an influence there. But I think that that's a beautiful Beatles slash pandemic mix-up, which is, I'm assuming, kind of what it was meant to be.
Right? It was, like, actually written all... We wrote the content before the pandemic and then recorded it, like, during and, like, towards the end.
I think just a lot of the themes applied. We were feeling, you know, isolation and loneliness and
even
existential
before.
Dread before.
Well...
But yeah, we recorded it during the pandemic and definitely like revisited the songs in a new light, and like they mean, you know, something new to us.
Yeah, and we put it in an order that I think was like conducive to the times.
So. Yeah, and makes sense to our older selves. So yeah.
Well, that is absolutely awesome. And All You Need Is Time, again, out now from Daisy the Great. And we're going to be hearing some music from it tonight. I'm very much looking forward to that. But since we started off talking about Record Player, could we go ahead and hear that track?
Yeah, sure.
Awesome. Okay.
I've got a record player that was made in 2014 that my hair blew. It came out of C6 order green. I like vintage dresses when they fall just below my knees. I pretend I squirt them climbing in the tree. Sometimes I think all I'm ever doing is trying to convince myself I'm sometimes I think all I'm ever doing is trying to convince myself I'm alive. Wipe my eyes and cut me off. Wipe my eyes, I'm crying. I'm just crying for attention, for attention. Wish I'd been convince myself I'm alive. I've got a record player that was made in 2014. Dyed my hair blue, it came out of some sort of green. And I did this dress was only for spin on my knees. I pretend I scraped it. Coming in the sun, tied a record player that was made in 2014. Dyed my hair blue, convince myself I'm alive. I like did this dress was only for spin on my knees. I pretend.
And again, if you're just now tuning in, we are joined by Daisy the Great, who have gone out of their way, not even playing in Kansas City, coming to play for you here on 90.9 The Bridge. And, you know, you started out not really even considering really that you were going to be musicians, from what I understand. I mean, you went to school for acting at NYU. And so that's how you met, right? You met in a class together. Yeah. Your first project, like your first song that you ever wrote together was as a class project.
Yeah.
What kind of, I'm just curious though, like, so what kind of actors did you want to be? I mean, you went to, and I mean, that was going to be your career, right?
Yeah.
I mean, I'll just speak for myself, but my mom is an opera singer. So I grew up singing and I grew up writing music, and I was kind of always torn between doing theater and writing, you know, like pop rock and folk stuff. And around the time I was going to school, I was deciding if I wanted to do a music degree or a theater degree. And I was just like, I've had so much music schooling so far, but I love doing theater that I felt like I needed to balance myself out and get that kind of acting, like core acting training. But I went into college planning to do both at the same time. And everyone was like, you're not going to be able to like be a musician and be an actor at the same time in college. And I was like, just watch me. And then I played one show at the bitter end. And then I was like, my schedule is so crazy. I can't do it. But it was interesting because basically as soon as we got out of school, I still at the time intended on doing theater and like Broadway and film stuff. But immediately we were like, we have so much like love for music and we have so much agency in this moment when we're like freshly out of college to work on something together, and it's something that we love doing. And it was just like really immediately fun and felt like we were able to put our energy into it and like get a return from like building the band, like finding friends, like making the shows happen. So it just happened really naturally, but it was always in there, you know?
Yeah. I always felt like I like really like loved performing. And I think like growing up, I grew up in New Orleans and my mom was a jazz singer, and just kind of like my school and everything. The like way for me to perform was to be like in like acting, like the acting program at my school, and like be in plays and musicals and stuff. And I think that like the world of like bands wasn't like a huge thing around where I was, at least like within like my like friendships and stuff in New Orleans. And then going to college, it kind of made me realize that like I really love performing, and like I really love performing stuff that I make more than like performing in something that somebody else made, because I like to like kind of speak what I'm feeling and thinking and stuff, and it just like made a lot more sense when I realized that like I could be a musician, because I didn't like play guitar or bass or anything until after college. I like learned, and it just felt like completely right. And I think that acting always felt like really fun, but not completely right.
Right. And you know when it's right.
Yeah.
And that you can hear that with the sound as well. And I read somewhere, and I mean, I'm sure you've probably shelved it at this point because you're really, really busy and on the road. But have you looked back at that musical you all were writing together?
Not in a while. It was like a Google Doc that I opened a while ago to just check up what it was. But we did start our first project, like right out of school, was making this musical that was about a band. And then basically immediately we wrote one big kind of theatrical song for the musical.
It was like an operetta.
It was like 8 minutes long. It had like every genre we could smush into it in there. And then we started to talk about what the band was going to play. And basically that day that we started talking about what the band was going to play, we never, ever looked at the musical again. Because we were like, I have this song that I wrote. I have this song that I wrote. I have this song. And then we were like, wow, we should sing it together. We should make this. We should do this. We should make a show. We should do. And it just like was immediately all of our energy was into band. And we were like, oh, we don't have to, you know, create a fictional reality to be a band. Like, you are allowed to just start a band. Yeah. You can just do what you want.
And I also think that, like, Kel and I both have, like, really, like, theatrical influences, like, you know, Bowie and Queen. And, like, I think that there's so much that we learned from, like, performing in that way. And, like, a lot of the reason why the album took so long to record is because we were having so much fun recording. Like, performing. Yeah. That we were, like, performing a bunch of songs. And we were like, okay, let's record them. But like I think we were performers first. It's super fun.
That's beautiful. And you can hear those influences too. I mean, even in Record Player, and as I was listening to it again while you were playing, I was like, man, you just hear like those Queen moments in there, right? With like that operatic kind of vibe. And I think I read, Minna, at one point you had said that you like it when things are kind of funky and weird, or when you have a way to like make it just a little bit different.
Definitely.
Yeah. I mean, I think our like rule is that there's no rules. And I think that like just the sound of our band is basically the sound of our two voices together, and then anything else that we want.
The songs change, like the genre changes completely if it needs to get the meaning of the song across. So we've definitely like jumped a lot of different vibes.
Yeah. Our goal is just like to keep playing, and like, yeah, if it gets weird, it gets weird.
It should get weird.
Absolutely.
You mentioned your mothers, and it's very much a musical household, an art household. And in addition to that, jazz, opera. Now, granted, I don't know if your family still lives in New Orleans or where they are, but have you ever collaborated with your family? Is this a thing like you've ever thought about doing, like with your moms?
I would love to. I mean, my collaboration with my mom. I grew up. I mean, my whole life was harmonizing with my mom. Like, she taught me how to sing, how to harmonize. Like, she introduced me to all the music that I loved growing up. So I would say definitely. I love singing with my mom, sure.
Oh, that's awesome. That's awesome.
Same.
I'm going to get her to do like a crazy opera thing.
You should.
Wait, we should get her on
that
a track.
That would be actually really cool.
And then we can get my mom to scat on a track.
And it will be called Mom Song.
Mom Song.
I look forward to that in the future.
Yeah. Mom Song.
If you're just now tuning in, we are joined today by Daisy the Great on 90.9 The Bridge, and we would love to get another song.
Sure.
Cool. All right. Glitter.
I paint my face with glitter in the morning light. I've been up all night. I've been up all night. It's just dirt on the kitchen floor, cold as an icebox. Fingernails tapping to the radiator, hum. Yell out loud at an old bowl of cereal. I'll clean up if anyone will call. Paintings hung up on the wall. My room is so much better off if I don't get involved. I neglected my plans to prove I would. Shoulda let the sun in, woulda done us good. Such a wannabe, dressing for the thrill like a pill. It's an armor, guess I'm not a threat. Guess I'm not a threat. Nighttime lunatic, the milk is turning sour, but I'd rather go dancing with a woman in the mirror. There's a ringing in my ears. I paint my face with glitter in the morning light. I've been up all night. I've been
And again, if you are tuning in, joined today by Daisy the Great, who have made a special trip into Kansas City. And I tell you what, just the beautiful harmonies. I mentioned at the beginning of the interview, record player and how much it had got attention it had gotten you. But I know you all have been busy writing, and you do this all the time. It seems, I mean, question, and I'm being very serious here. Like, do you guys take breaks?
It's funny to ask us, like, what the first week of tour, we were like looking ahead at our drives. They're all like 8-10 hour drives with the show that night. We're like, how are we going to do that? I think it goes in waves. Sometimes we definitely have time to, you know, do like stuff that we want to do and just fill our own days, make our own routines. But when it's like a tour time or an album, like single release, album release moment, it definitely gets super, super busy. And it's just interesting to get used to that kind of like ebb and flow of like work energy that is needed.
Me and Kyle definitely do like we used to like work constantly, like all the time, nonstop work, and then we were like getting really fatigued and like jaded feeling. And we started doing this thing. I mean, unless it's like really like an intense time, and you know, tour is different. Obviously, tour is something out of time and space, and right. Absurd that anybody does it, honestly. It's crazy on the body. Every time we tour, I like end the tour and I'm like, I look 5 years older.
But it's like a month.
Yeah, and it's like a month. But it's awesome too. We love it. But yeah, we've done this thing, like we live like a 10-minute walk from each other. So like when we have like work days and stuff where we're just like working on stuff all day, we usually kind of call it at like 6 or 7. Like we'll meet in the morning and then work all day and like treat it like a job where like, you know, you still have a night to like do the things you need to do. And like that's been really helpful. Yeah.
It was hard to learn. Like I think anything that's your project or something that's fun that, like, too. You're making your own hours and you enjoy it. It's right. Really challenging to be like, okay, I'm going to work from 6 to 10 and then I'm gonna stop doing it. I'm gonna do it again tomorrow. Or like, oh, it's the weekend. Like, let me just pause this until Monday. Like if it's not urgent, it's okay to just like do something else.
But I definitely do stay up till 6 a.m. I know, sometimes writing
hard
songs.
To resist, like, but we try to resist.
I get that. 100%. And it shows, I think, in your music. And you know, I think I honestly, and other people here when they do interviews, they say this too. And I think it's just one of those things that's like, oh, I don't want to talk about the pandemic again, because I know we've all talked. But I honestly think it needs to be a genre at this point, you know, like the pandemic records.
Yeah, that's
like
so interesting.
And so you've done a lot. You've got this new album, again, out on S-Curve. If you're just now tuning in, Daisy the Great, and All You Need Is Time. But you did this beautiful soft songs EP during that. And I know that at one point you had said, like, somebody had asked you what your favorite thing is that you've done right now. And do you want to talk, like, why was that your favorite one? Can you kind of deconstruct that for me?
Definitely. Yeah. That project started like really early in the pandemic. And we put out, I think, the first song almost 2 weeks into the pandemic. And I think part of that was definitely what we were just talking about, of being really used to having like something to do every day together and like have a lot of work to be done and progress to make that we could see happen. And I think the first song that we wrote was kind of a response to like the shock of not having that thing there. And also, like, I went to go be with my mom in Connecticut, so we were also like separated from each other and like the rest of our friends in that time. And it really, We wrote that whole EP like over FaceTime every day. It's exactly what we were just saying. We just filled it with like FaceTime calls instead of going to the coffee shop.
Yeah. And also, like, those songs are still the most recent songs we've written. Like the album that's out, the new album is like the newest songs that we've recorded, obviously, and like the newest.
Yeah, it's like the
record
newest
we
sound.
Have. It's the newest sound, but the soft songs record, like the actual lyrics and music we wrote, that's like kind of the most current brain of ours, if you know what I mean.
Yeah. Well, and speaking of your friends, I know. So today we're joined by 4 of the people who are in your traveling band here, because it can be quite a production. I mean, and that's another thing. I think where you're maybe, and I'm just extrapolating here, and please tell me if I'm wrong, but where that kind of theater background comes in as well, because I mean, man, we got your original stage plot and it was like 27 inputs. Yeah. And it's like, you really do. I mean, yeah. But in a good, great way. I mean, it's like you have really deconstructed and thought about every single thing, and it's very purposeful.
Thank you. Yeah. We also just enjoy having, like, when we play a show, to have a sound be live. Like, we have a lot of stacked harmonies and stuff, and Nardo, who's here playing guitar, and then Bree, who's not with us on this tour, but Bree does backup harms as well. So it's like, if it's a four-part harmony, we love having four people singing it instead of, like, just having it in there. But, yeah.
Yeah, we originally, like, so we opened up to the idea of tracks because we wanted our, like, live sound, like, wherever we were, to, like, sound like the record. But at first we were like, okay, so how are we gonna get, like, cello?
Yeah. Like, to every show.
Like, and then we'll get, like, the horn player to come in. We're like, we can't, like, you know, be a four piece and do that. So yeah, but we try to do as many live sounds as possible.
Well, and that also goes, I mean, Kelly, you had said that when you were younger, you know, like, you were in madrigals in high school. Oh, yeah. But that, I mean, so you wrote, like that was part of your projects, wasn't it? Like, that where you just wrote, talked about it. You'll say it better than I do.
No, don't worry. Like, yeah. So I was deeply invested in chorus throughout high school and obviously middle school as well. But in my school, we had chorus, and then we had, like, a second smaller chorus that was the madrigals, that worked on sometimes a cappella stuff, but more often just, like, really close harms and, like, really kind of just complicated music. But I did start to arrange songs for it. And the first one I did was Hide and Seek by Imogen Heap, which was really exciting. I was like, I said that I wanted to do it. And then I went home and I, like, downloaded Sibelius, and I just did the entire song that night, and, like, none of my homework. I got back the next day and I was like, I finished it. And my teacher was like, whoa, that's pretty crazy. But so that was just really exciting. I remember, like, listening to it and being like, this sounds kind of like a mechanical sound, and trying to turn that into, like, a 7-part vocal. But that's where, like, that's where the record player song started, right? Was, like, pretty almost right then. I think I was, like, 18 when I started it. And I just had, like, stacked vocals, and I was at the time playing music by myself, and I was like, I don't, same thing, like, I wanted it to be live, and I was like, I don't know what to do. Like, I don't have a band.
I think like, something that, like, Kel and I had in common, and, like, kind of why we started writing together, is, like, our main instrument is our voice.
Yeah.
And I think that, like, before we could really play a lot of like, we've learned instruments over time, but, like, before we could play instruments, the way that we wrote music is that we'd, like, go into GarageBand and, like, use our voice as the instrument, just to, like, have something there. And then, like I would be like, okay, this is the guitar part, like, whatever. Yeah. And, like, but, like, I couldn't play it, so we would sing it. And I think that, like, kind of led to where the sound is.
Yeah.
Right. Well, and Minna, you're no slouch. I mean, you were writing songs when you were 5 years old and, like, singing them to people as they walked by in New Orleans, right?
Yeah. Yeah. And honestly, I didn't even, like, know the extent of it, but I, like, because I, like, had all these home videos that I thought flooded in Katrina. And then recently, for our video Time Machine, I was like, maybe there's still some videos. And I, like, called my mom. I was like, hey, I need some, like, home videos. Do we have any? She was like, yeah, we have a ton. I'm going to get them digitized. And, like, I pleaded with her to digitize them in a swift fashion, and I would pay for it.
For the video coming out in
a few days. I was like, oh, can you do this really quick? But she sent me so much footage, and literally all, I'm like, so annoying. And all, and like, literally every second of the footage, I'm going, like, I have this, like, low, I still have, like, a low raspy voice, but, like, I had a lower raspy voice. Like, I think I aged backwards or something, because I sound in these videos like I smoke, like, 10 packs a day.
Benjamina,
I'm going,
button,
like, baby, your eyes are amazing. Like, that's, like, exactly how I sound. And I'm just, like, constantly making up songs, and, like, my mom, I'm just like, look at me, like, with the camera and stuff. Yeah. It's, like, pretty embarrassing, but Yeah, that was meant to be a performer.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, well, and that's the thing. So you said you didn't know that you were going to be a band. And so you basically became a band just by, you know, playing with friends and kind of collecting people on the along the way, like you collect Pokemon, you know, with like different amazing powers. Right. Because as we've heard so far, like you're joined by Nardo, who plays like however many instruments and also sings and is in like six bands in New York. Like, are you still in those bands? How does that work on the road?
Yeah. So me and Mati over their own drums actually collab in a lot of the bands, and I write my own songs as Panther Hollow, and then which Mati's also in,
and, and also Mati, who solid drums, man. Like, and I know you don't have a microphone,
he says thank you so much.
Yeah, me and Mati just do music. Yeah. It's just
yeah, it's constant. They do it. We actually have a plan though for like when we headline to like make a song where we all switch instruments, so we all have to learn them.
That's I want
to
play the drums.
Brilliant. Thanks. And your mom's on stage.
Exactly.
Okay, cool. That being said, if you're just now tuning in, joined by Daisy the Great today here on 90.9 The Bridge, and we'd love to get another song.
Sure. All right. Ooh. The song's called Liar.
Ooh. I exhausted all the words I know, trying to find seven L's in code, so it's still open living so I can take it back. If you said let's be friends instead or something else like that, and when we talk I ramble to fill in the space and time. When I kiss you I'm always rambling. Are you on to me? Am I the villain? Am I just a young embarrassed kid? Is this letting me down easy? Which one of us can take the hint? And when we talk, I ramble to fill in the space and time. When I kiss you, I'm
track Liar, which our listeners will be familiar with here on 90.9 The Bridge, as we are again joined by Daisy the Great today in the Bridge studios. And before the track there, we were talking about all of your artistic pasts in relation to music. But I did also want to mention, you know, Minna, we had talked about how your mom is a jazz singer, but your dad is also, I mean, an artist. And mm-hmm. you also have that as well. And that, I mean, you do all of this stuff for the band. Is that correct?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I do all the art for the band. My dad was a painter, and he taught my mom to paint, and she's also a painter. And that's kind of like her main gig now. My dad passed when I was six, and Kel's father also passed, so that's something we bonded over kind of from the get-go. I kind of just learned how to make, like, paint and stuff by watching them, and I feel like a lot of my style, like, developed through making stuff for the band, too.
I did wonder, because I read, like, you sometimes use your paintings as inspiration for songs. Is that correct?
Yeah, there's like some, specifically one song on the first record we put out, the I'm Not Getting Any Taller, the song Last Kisses is like about this, I made this drawing of like these two people being held like in the sky by this giant hand holding them by their feet, and they're back to back, and they're like doing like an arch back into like a heart and like kissing backwards. I wrote this poem called Last Kisses, which is the very end of the song Last Kisses. And then we like built the song around that.
I love you guys. It's like any art form you can think of. Yeah, they do that. It's just like poems, painting, music, acting. True artists joining us for Thanks. Daisy the Great today here in our 90.9 The Bridge studios. You know, we do this segment at the station called Sound Minds, in which we look at how music has an impact on people, and not only artists who create it, but also the listeners. And you both had really poignant quotes at different times. Mm. And Kelly, I'm going to start with you. One of the things that you had said is that, you know, so words, they get stuck in our head. And sometimes it takes that music to express things. You know, it fuels that connection to let you know that you're not alone.
Yeah.
And that's something that we say here a lot on the station. You know, like Brian, he says it all the time in the morning show. Like, we just want to let you know you're not alone. And especially at a time when we came out of the pandemic and things like that. But does that play... Does any of that... Well, can you speak more to your quote? Let's just do it that way.
Sure. Yeah. I think that as... just a person, like not as a songwriter or singer, I found that a lot of my ways of processing came from listening to music and like singing that music, like not necessarily like in a skilled way, but just like engaging with music. And I think it just like lights up a part of your brain that helps to like move things. So I think if anything feels like stuck or you're trying to process something, like listening to music or writing music may not like, you know, change the situation, but it definitely like allows for some movement and space and understanding, and helps to process whatever you're going through. And also I think just music in general is so communal that, you know, having a piece of music that other people know, or like singing music, being around music with other people, just immediately connects you to them and is just feels like the quickest way to get to your soul. I love music for that reason. I like writing music for that reason. And also like as a songwriter, it does the same thing. Like if we write a song and then share it with someone, like as soon as we play it for an audience, it just like becomes communal and like becomes their thing too, even if it's like, this is about my like old, you know, whatever, like my ex problem, that whatever, like it just changes once you give it away. So
it even changes for us. That's something we talk about all the time. It's like, we wrote this song about like some people will be like, is this song about this person? And you're like, honestly, like I wrote it about this person, but now it's about this. Like, when you listen to music, like the way that it affects you and the way it applies to you changes, like even when you wrote it.
Yeah.
Well, and it's universal, right?
Yeah.
It's that universal language. And then Minna, you had said that, we need to stay open and available in order for our creativity to move through us as part of that process as well. And from like a mental standpoint,
I said that.
You did. It was very profound.
Nice. Like,
but you mentioned too, I mean, that, and that ends up taking a lot of ego out of the equation as well. It just comes down, I think, more to what Kelly was saying and what you had just said as well, that it's all about the you know, the soul and what it is that mm-hmm. makes us make music and yeah. listen to it, right?
Yeah, totally.
Okay. You're like, I'm going to stick with what I said before. That was
yeah.
good.
No, I do think like, yeah, you got to stay open to creativity and like, let it like, yeah, let it move through you. I think it's like, it's not what you, I'm going to butcher myself right now. But I do think it's just nice to think of it as something that is moving through you and not like something that you're like making up on your own, because I think that it, like you said, takes the ego out of it, and like lets you like just be like the best kind of like vessel yeah. that you can be.
And I definitely feel like like the songs like find us. Like I don't think we don't like sit, I mean sometimes obviously we sit and like work hard at it, but
and
I
usually
think,
those are the bad ones.
Yeah, so I feel like the songs that are the best songs that feel like the truest are songs that happen sometimes like right like the chunks of them happen in a big spurt of just kind of like, this is what it is, it like can't be anything other than this. Mm-hmm. And then it's helpful to look at it that way, because then you're like, I can't really critique this, because like this is what that is, like I just wrote down what that is and it can't be anything else. Yeah. So there's nothing to talk about.
And you know, like that it wasn't just you writing it, because you're just like, there's no way, like this is like
that seems to be kind of how everything has happened for you all though, because you know, you kind of came together serendipitously. I mean, you talk about how you developed and created this band, just you didn't know what you were doing. You just yeah. did it. Right? And the things that worked ended up being why you're here now. And so thank you for of being course. Here now.
Thank
and
you.
We love having you. That being said, can we get one more song?
Of oh, course. Yeah. This is All Time right. Machine. It's about the end of the world.
It's appropriate.
Yeah.
Are you listening to the clocks in this house? They are growling at me. They are growling at me. Saying, how can it be that the whole world is falling. The sky is burning, no more need to hurry. We were right to worry, we were right to worry. The birds are gone now, the time has come now. Just close your eyes now, just close your eyes now. The sea is crying, the moon is sighing, it's terrifying, it's terrifying, it's all around us, the end has crowned us, the star has fallen. If I go back, will I do it all the same again? If I go back, if I go back, will I do it all the same again? If I go back, if I go back, will I do it all the same again?
Oh, very good. Joined by Daisy the Great here in the Bridge Studios on 90.9 The Bridge. And I hope you would do it all the same because that's what led you to us.
Thank you.
So thanks for being here with us.
Thank you.
Again, Daisy the Great have a brand new album called All You Need Is Time out on S-Curve. And please do yourself a favor and check it out from start to finish because it's a beautiful album. And thank you for driving 9 hours out of your way to, you know,
you
do
so
this
much.
Session for
It's been
the
a
bridge.
Pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Daisy the Great on 90.9 The Bridge.
Thank you.
Thank you.